is working. Good evening, everybody. You already seated before I said be seated. It's all right. I'd like to thank our dear brother, Pastor Josephine Ratchett, for his kindness to invite me back to this wonderful conference. This is our annual family gathering, right? And many of you come regularly, and we are very surprised that more than 50% are first timers here. Whether you are first timers or all timers, this is our annual family gathering. Amen. Before I share the word of God with you, I want to introduce to you a new book that I've written called On Dove's Wings. This is a record-breaking book that I've written because it took me, I started writing this book in 1997 and I just got it finished now. Actually, I got it finished in 1997 itself, and only the last chapter was remaining. And I do not know any reason why that last chapter took me close to 18 years to finish. I kind of almost totally forgot about this and left it on the on my shelf, you know. But a month ago, the Lord spoke to me, now the time has come to introduce this subject, because great is the glory of God that is going to be poured out upon the face of the earth, and the people of God must know about, or this book is about, the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit. I'm sure you may have read about the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit and read many books about the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit. And among the many books in the Christian world today, what is unique about this book? You may ask. The uniqueness about this book is, you know, after I got filled in the Holy Spirit, I was so hungry to learn more about the things of God, or particularly about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Because when I got baptized in the Holy Spirit, it was under a man of God in India who moved very powerfully in all the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So I admired him, the way that he moved in the Spirit, and I began to hunger and thirst and pray after that I too should be blessed with those gifts. So about a year later, I met another man of God from Sri Lanka, who moved very powerfully in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And very particularly, he had a very rich anointing of the gift of the word of knowledge in his ministry. He had very powerful, very accurate gift of the word of knowledge. It was like second nature to him. So I was like an assistant to him, bringing him from place to place. So after one powerful meeting, where I witnessed close hand how he had a powerful word of knowledge concerning the owner of a very large hotel in Singapore. And he had a very accurate knowledge about his illness in his body. And then when the word was spoken, and that man was instantly healed. So when we were driving back, I asked him, Pastor, please tell me, how did you get this word of knowledge? So he told me, it just comes. So I asked him, how did it come? So he told me, it just came. I said, yes, Pastor, it came. But how did it come? So he thought for a while. He said, you just know. I said, yes, Pastor, it came and you knew, but how did you know it came? So he said, you just know. I said, Pastor, I know we should know, but how to know? He thought for a while. He said, son, when this gift is in your life, you will know that you know that you know it came. So after that, he closed his eyes to pray so that I will not bother him with more questions. But that question, that answer did not satisfy my curiosity, because I needed to know how to know that it came. You needed to know so that you can flow effectively in the gifts, so that you can recognize that it has come, so that you will know that it's not your own vain imagination thinking that you imagine things, so that you will know beyond a shadow of doubt you're not imagining things, but it was a genuine manifestation of a gift of the Holy Spirit. So this man of God, as good and sincere as he is, could not answer my question. So that left me with no choice but to go to the source. So I bent my knees, I fasted and I prayed and asked the Lord to teach me. Please teach me the mechanics, the technicalities of how the gifts operate, so that I can not only practice it in my own life, but also share it with every other common people like me who may want to flow in the gifts. So this book is a result of those years of research from the Holy Spirit. And in this book, I trace each gift, first explaining what they are, the definition of it, and then looking into the many biblical examples, how they have manifested in the lives of many other prophets or patriarchs or disciples, and then looking at the life of the Lord Jesus, how this gift manifested in his life, and then the operation. How does this gift manifest? How they operate? And finally is, you know, when you receive one gift, there are seven anointings on each gift, 7 degrees of anointings that you can progressively grow from glory to glory to glory until you flow in the fullness of the anointings on one particular gift. So the last portion will be how to sharpen the gift. You sharpen it so that anointing increases. You sharpen it again and then it increases. The anointing increases. So I was writing the last chapter. The last chapter is the gift of diverse kinds of tongues and the interpretation of tongues. You know, I trace all the gifts also from the life of the Lord Jesus. And when I looked at that gift of diverse kinds of tongues, we don't ever read about the Lord Jesus Christ speaking in tongues. Have you? No. So I thought, okay, this gift, among all the 9 gifts, 2 gifts did not manifest in the life of the Lord Jesus. That's what most books that I've read also teach. But as I was about to skip that portion and go to the last portion, the Holy Spirit told me, no, even that gift manifested in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. I asked him where, and then he showed me a scripture passage where that gift manifested in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. So all the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit, they also manifested in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is one book that you don't want to miss, because in these last days, God is going to pour out his glory upon the church in a great manner. Amen. So this is available at our book table outside. And this book was written and printed in a record time, just in time for this conference. So you are so blessed to receive this one. Now this is part one. This is just part one. Part two will come out next month. Part two will be a sequel to this book called On Eagle's Wings. So the On Eagle's Wings are about the seven spirits of God. So this is prequel, and then there'll be a sequel. Last night we heard a wonderful message from our dear brother Neville Johnson, and we talked about it, you know, the night before when we met for dinner, about all these messages of judgment and chastisement for not only America, for many nations of the world. And we know from scriptures that when God judges, it is not for total annihilation or destruction, but towards redemption, to bring, to woo the church, or to woo the believers, or to woo a nation back to himself. Sometimes he speaks lovingly. Not sometimes, most of the time. He speaks very lovingly, very kindly, trying to bring words of correction in a very, very loving and kind manner. But you know from experience, we all are very, very obstinate and stubborn people. Amen? If you are not, at least I am. So, what's the way to arrest our attention? You know, in India, the farmers, they will try to discipline a obstinate, stubborn cow. You know, the cows are sometimes, many times, very, very stubborn. The cow herd will tell the cow to walk in one direction. Sometimes they obey, many times they don't obey. So they'll walk in another direction. So, and he will lovingly, you know, coax it and beat it with a stick. And when this, that is not being inhumane, you know, beating with a stick. And when they still don't obey, you know what the man does? He breaks the cow's leg. So does a shepherd does the same thing. Have you heard of that?
Yes.
He breaks the leg and then he bandages the wound, and the shepherd will carry the sheep on his shoulder all throughout the healing process. Initially, the sheep is very angry with the shepherd for breaking his leg. Who wouldn't? If your father break your leg, how would you feel? You will want to kick him with the other good leg. Wouldn't you? Right? But when the sheep sees the shepherd carrying him all throughout the healing process, the sheep realizes the shepherd really loves him. And this breaking was for good. And through that breaking and the eventual healing process, the sheep realizes that it was broken to learn how to obey. And then when its bones are joined back together, when it's healed and well, the sheep will obey. So in the same manner, God judges, disciplines, to bring us back to himself. The scripture says, no, mercy always triumphs over judgment. Amen. So last night we heard about that. So all is not doom and gloom. There is good hope that just like the phoenix rose up from the fire and ashes, so will the great United States of America rise up back to her former place of call and destiny. Amen. Now, our dear Pastor Joseph Sweet has written a book called the resurrection of the United States of America. And he very aptly has subtitled it called A Word of Hope. In this book, his very first book, normally people write the first book, a word or good book, you know. But his very first book is a book about judgments. He has been blessed by God to see many, many visions and dreams concerning the United States of America. You know, God is speaking not only through prophets from outside the country, but also from inside the country. But why does God need to also speak from prophets from outside? Because you don't want to listen to people from your own country. So when you don't want to listen to people from your own country, God had to bring a white man from the land below the other part of the world. And a raven from the east. To share with you the same message. But when a foreigner says, it appeals to us. But God has raised up many, many wonderful prophets, even from within the U.S. One such great prophet of God was David Wilkerson. A mighty prophet of God that God raised to speak to the nation about many judgments that God was showing. And even now, Dr. Billy Graham, in his last years, has been bringing out many, many messages of warning, which he has never done all throughout his life during his early years of ministry, no? He was more of an evangelist. But now, in his last stage of his life, he's bringing words about judgment, bringing words about the second coming of the Lord, and words about preparing to meet God. So this book is contains many, many wonderful visions and dreams about prospering in the midst of chaos and disruption. The many visions our dear pastor had seen. So when he was sharing with me about this message in a few months ago, in the month of June, I just felt in my heart that we should make this into a TV program to be aired on our network during your Independence Day. So we did a TV program special right here in this church. I interviewed him based on all the visions and the dreams they had seen. Many things that you don't read in this book were on the TV program, where I also shared about the many visions that I saw very recently concerning the United States in the month of June when I was in Costa Mesa, California, and in Houston. That really scared me like never before all my life. Even today, it rattles my bone from June till now. The reason is because I'm hearing the same word spoken by the Lord repeatedly in great urgency. This has never happened in the past. You know, nature tells us, and so does Matthew 24 verse 8 tells us, that as a woman nears her delivery period, her labor pains increases, right? So the labor pains increases to signal the time has come. The time has come. Likewise, when this urgency was increasing, I felt that in my spirit. You know, I clearly remember Brother Neville and I were speaking at a conference in St. Louis. And that night I was going to speak. And while the worship was going on, I saw the heavens open. And I saw the Lord Jesus seated among the prophets in a council in heaven. And that was the first time I saw that. And the word of the Lord that came was, very soon, the destiny of the U.S. will be decided. This was about 10, 12 years ago, or more than that. And over the last year, few years, God has spoken to me many things concerning the U.S., but it had not made a dent on me as much as it did in the month of June. It really, really, I don't want to use the word scared, but for lack of a better word, I want to use that word, scared. I'm not scared, you know. Why should I be scared? I'm not scared. I'm concerned. Concerned because of the gravity of what was spoken and the urgency of what was spoken. So we made a TV program to be aired on July 4th. And many people wrote to us saying, oh, we missed the program because we are busy with all kinds of Independence Day festivities. So they said, will it be repeated again? No, it was not repeated again. But we made a DVD of that program. So the DVD of the program, together with this book, is a companion volume. So you'll get both together. I'm sure during this conference you bought this book separately or this DVD separately. But if you'll go to the book table, you will not get a refund, but you'll get one of these. But from today onwards, this is a combo. You'll get two for the price of one. Isn't that a great deal? This is a special Lancaster conference combo. I hope I'm being a good salesman, you know. You think so? My brother doesn't think so, you know. He tells me, if you ever give up the ministry, don't ever become a businessman. Because you'll go bankrupt very soon. You will just give away everything to people who come and ask you. So, you don't want to miss hearing what God has spoken in this program. Now, this afternoon, as I was waiting on the Lord, now, this is not my message today, but I saw into heaven, and I saw the prophetic council in heaven. And the Lord told me, I saw them discussing about the affairs of the state of the United States. And the chief presiding elder in the council, he told me, he said, tell the people, judgment will be poured out very soon upon this nation. So, as usual, I was very, very concerned. So I always plead with the Lord. But what about the righteous people? What about the good people? What about the remnant people? So when I pleaded, they gave me a word of advice for you. What you should do so that you can escape from the wrath to come. Turn with me to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 9. Ezekiel chapter 9. And let's read from verse 1, okay? He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lie toward the north, and every man with a slaughter weapon in his hand. Now these are angels, they are not ordinary humans, you know. And one man among them was clothed with a linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the bronze altar. And the glory of God of Israel was gone up from the cherub upon which he was, and to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen who had the writer's ink horn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry. Now you want to underline that. Set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that are done in the midst of it. And to the others he said in mine hearing, go after him through the city and smite. Let not your eye spare, neither have pity. Slay utterly old and the young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Sanctuary means the church. Then they began with the ancient men who were before the house. You know, begin at my sanctuary is what is written in 1 Peter 4:17. Judgment must begin in the house of God. So, who will be protected? Verse 4. Set a mark upon the foreheads of the men and the women that sigh and cry for the sins of the land. So if you sigh and cry for the sins of this land, that crying will do two work. One, you are interceding for the land. Secondly, it purifies you. It purifies you because when you cry and you pray, then your own shortcomings are also brought to the forefront for you to repent over your own sins. Some things that are lurking and hiding below the surface that you don't know, they will be brought up to the front. And you will then remember what you have done. And you will repent and you will pray. And thereby, that prayer will sanctify you. That prayer will purify you and cause the angels to put a mark on your forehead. Okay, these are the God's remnant. They will be protected when the judgment comes. Amen? So this is what you need to do. Shall we pray? Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence in the name of our dear Lord Jesus Christ right now. Thank you, Holy Father, for bringing us from far and near today. We have gathered here, Lord, same time, same month, same days, every year, presenting our service to you. As you have commanded the children of Israel to come and present themselves to you once a year. So now we come, all your dear children, from far and near. Even these who are far off and watching this webcast from all over the world. Now I ask you, Lord Jesus, embrace every one of your dear ones to your bosom right now. Embrace every one of them to your bosom, Lord. And I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that heaven will now witness what we are speaking, what we are meditating, what we are thinking, the thoughts of our hearts, and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord. Open our hearts, Spirit of the living God. Open our ears that we may hear what the Spirit of God is speaking to the churches in these last days. And teach us, Lord, what we should do, that we should, and how we should prepare ourselves for what you are going to do in these last days. In the name of our dear Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. The message of my message is entitled "The Last Days Anointing." You know, you've been hearing quite frequently, if you have been coming to our conference in this church, one word that is constantly repeated by our respected prophet of God, Neville Johnson, and many others is, in the last days, there will gross darkness will cover the earth. And in the midst of gross darkness, there will be great light. And last night you heard Brother Neville mentioning that, and as darkness sweeps into the church gets smaller and brighter. Do you remember? The church gets smaller. It's because the tares are blown away. The goats are all slaughtered. They're not just sent away. If they're sent away, they will rot somewhere, or they'll spoil another sheepfold. So they're slaughtered. So the tares are removed, bounded, and burned. The chaff blown away. The goat slaughtered. So when you do all that, a huge, big, mega church will become very small. Right? Will become very small. That's what a remnant is. When it becomes very small, that will be the purest group. The purest group with the greatest light that will shine forth from them. One. They join together. The intensity of the brightness and the glory will become greater, because during the process of separation, of purification, of refinement, these who had some light, when they are purified, they become brighter. They become more glorious. So that is why during this period of pruning, during this period of refining and judgment, the church, so small remnant church, becomes brighter and more glorious. So when that happens, God will pour out the last final display of his glory in such a manner that the world has never known before. About a month ago, the word of the Lord came unto me to make known the gifts of the Holy Spirit and the seven spirits of God. That is why I wrote that book. Now, on August 11, just a few days before this conference, I was coming to this conference, and my flight took me around Japan. There was a stopover in Japan at Narita Airport. And then from there, we have to come to Los Angeles. So after the transit period, and they announced that the plane is now ready to take off. So everybody start boarding. So I queued and I was cleared. As I was walking on the bridge towards the plane, suddenly I felt a presence come alongside me. You know, if you read Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 15, when the two disciples were walking down the road to Emmaus, they were just pondering and talking among themselves. And when suddenly the Lord Jesus came and joined them. So when I felt that presence come and join me, I turned around and I saw the Lord Jesus Christ. He came, he walked with me, and he said, "At this conference, you shall declare the beginnings of the manifestation of the powers of the age to come. The last day's anointing that will be poured out upon this world." You know, many true servants of God, true ministers of God and true believers of God. Whether you are in full-time ministry, part-time ministry, quarter-time ministry, or free-time ministry, it doesn't matter, you know, which time of ministry. What matters more is serving God with a whole heart. That matters more. You know, you can be in full-time ministry, but your heart may not be there. But someone who does not get a salary, someone who volunteers himself, they will put their whole heart and soul to do a menial task. And God looks at that. Or they put their whole heart, just like what Pastor Joe Sweet shared earlier about this man looking at his giving records in heaven. He gave grudgingly. He gave unwillingly. Oh, he gave with a cheerful, smiling heart. Did not count how much was in his wallet or handbag and took everything and gave it freely. See, what matters is the attitude of your heart. That counts more than anything else. So, even the little children, the youths, the senior citizens, those who are like what today the clergy would classify as believers warming the pews. Have you heard of that term? Warming the pews. You're not doing anything. Some are genuinely warming the pews. They are genuine means they really want to warm the pews. Then there are others who like to do something, but they are prevented. They are prevented. These are they who are like the donkey and the foal of the donkey that is tied to the doorpost. They are tied. They are bounded. See, a donkey is an animal of a beast of burden. He's supposed to do work. But here you read, this donkey all his life, till it gave birth, was tied to a post. That's not a donkey supposed to be. But it was never put to use. Just tied. The donkey and his little foal. So when I read that, I pondered, you know. Means the donkey got married. And then it gave birth to a baby. Now listen. When I say married, don't think like what's happening today. We are not talking about bisexuality, no? We are just talking about donkey and donkey. Not donkey and man. Okay? Are you clear on that? Okay. One donkey after its own kind. You see how corrupted our society has become today, that every sentence has to be qualified so that it sounds correct. So, this donkey with another donkey, they started a family. And it's such a fall, but it got divorced. Because the male was not to be found. So anyway, the donkey and its little foal, kid, they were tied to a doorpost, never used. Never used. The scripture says, no man has ever sat on it. No one. Never used for traveling. Never used for carrying stuffs. Never used. Just lying there like a virgin. And there are many, many sincere people like that in the church. There are the little children like that. There are the youths like that. And there are senior citizens like that. just waiting for the moving of the waters to come in their lives. I have good news for you. All such people will hear the Spirit of the Lord say, come. Your time has now come. Come. Amen. So upon such people, God will pour out His last day's anointing so that you can do great exploits for God in these last days. There will be a great outpouring of the glory of God, a great demonstration of the power of God before the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. This was something that was prophesied by many, many true prophets of God for the last hundreds of years. Even in modern day Pentecostal charismatic Christianity, genuine men of God who rose up, they have prophesied that. The late great man of God, apostle of faith, Smith Wigglesworth, when he went to Australia, he prophesied that the Holy Spirit will blow upon the great Southland. But nothing has happened in Australia so far yet. But when these winds starts blowing from one end of Australia to another end of Australia, the army of God will rise up like a great army and do great exploits for God. So like Smith Wigglesworth, there are many, many other men of God who have prophesied about the last day's harvest. There's one last harvest that is going to come. And that harvest that will come will be demonstrated with great power and great glory. August 7, 2008, we were in Baton Rouge, Louisiana for a conference. So I was praying that afternoon, asking God what I should share in the meetings, when I saw four angels appeared in my room. And among the four, one appeared to be the captain of them. And he spoke to me, said, "We are the angels of the state of Louisiana. And when the Katrina devastated this state, we oversaw the flight, the path that Katrina should take." Nothing takes place by accident, you know. You know, when the weatherman tracks the movement of a typhoon or a hurricane, how can the typhoon or hurricane knows which city to come and strike? Do they have a brain for them to know, okay, which time of the year to come? You know, if you notice, they all make annual visits. Are they wearing a watch? Do they have a smartphone or an iWatch? Look at the comets. Even the comets, no? They make annual visits. Scientists have tracked them that every particular year, this comet will pass by the Earth. I used to wonder, how is it possible for a comet to know when once in every 88 years pass by Earth? The comet Shoemaker, it annually visits Earth at one particular given period of time. How does it know? How does it know? Is it wearing a watch? Or does it have a computer that it looks at? Okay, now the time has come. Let's pass by Earth. How does it know? Or how does all these hurricanes and typhoons, each has a name? They know exactly when to come and which places to strike. How do they know? So for many years I had these questions. How? Until one day I was taught how. It is the angels of destruction that commands them, charts their flight movement. Just like pilots who plan a flight path. Their flight, their movements are all charted. Nothing takes place by accident. Everything is predetermined. Predetermined and pre-planned. If you read Daniel chapter 4, King Nebuchadnezzar sees a dream, and the prophet Daniel interprets the dream, and he says, the watchers have determined, they have planned, the watchers in heaven have determined, this is what that is going to take place. Determined means something that's already planned. Already planned. This is what's going to take place. Cannot be altered. But there was a way to alter it. But because King Nebuchadnezzar did not set his heart to humble himself, not only humbling, you know, the scripture says there, you should also do good to the poor. Do charitable works. Two things. The acts of kindness that you show to others is a result of a heart that has humbled itself. So two things must be the fruit of a repentant heart. One, you humble yourselves. Second, you do good to others, especially to the poor, the underprivileged people. You do acts of kindness, acts of charity, acts of goodness. Help the poor. Help clothe the naked. Feed the hungry. Visit the widows. Visit the fatherless. Good works. You should do that. And then, humble yourselves. King Nebuchadnezzar did not do this too. Exactly 1 year after when the word was first given to him, the judgment fell upon him as it was predetermined. In the same manner, all these things are predetermined. So this angel came after identifying himself and what took place in the state of Louisiana. Then he said, this is what you need to share at the meeting this time. Say, God is going to reveal his awesome, mighty power kept hidden from the ages since creation. That's exactly how I reacted. Wow. Such a power has been kept hidden from the beginnings of ages. You know, if you read the epistles that the Apostle Paul wrote, he will write that this wisdom was kept hidden, but now has been made manifest. Likewise, they use the same word. This power has been kept hidden from the ages of time, but is going to be revealed in the last days. So what kind of great power? As I was thinking in my mind, the angel answered me, even the angels in heaven have not seen such a power of the Holy Spirit yet. Now that really blew me off. You know, all the angels in heaven who have seen or witnessed God demonstrating his awesome power in speaking the worlds into creation. He spoke and the galaxies came. He spoke this, he spoke that, everything came into being. Such power, the angel says, pales in comparison to what God is going to do in these last days. Amen. That is a very, very weak appreciation to what. You know what actually you should have done? As soon as you heard that, you should have reacted just like how they do in the ball game. Stand up to your feet, pump in the air, and give a big shout, amen, and thank you to the Almighty God. Amen. Eyes have not seen. eyes have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the mind what God is going to do in these last days. Amen. That is the reason why God is sending his judgments, to purify, to refine, to take for himself a people with whom he can entrust this last day's powers of God. You know, if you look in the past, church history and biblical history best record that in the past, if you look from Bible history till now, God has raised up many, many wonderful saints of God, prophets, patriarchs, men and women of God, who were given some of the powers. But look what they did. They messed up everything. Adam was the first person who was given these powers of the age to come. He had complete power and authority over everything in the air, everything on the land, and everything in the sea. Everything. He had all the power, all the authority over the three forces of nature. That was the powers of the age to come. He possessed that. But what did he do? He sold it over to the devil. And then over the period of time, the Lord raised up many people and gave them limited power. Now contained within the Holy Spirit. Now what did we do again? Again we blew up everything. Again we traded it for a mere bowl of soup. One person did that for one bowl of soup, sold his birthright. Then came another man, for the lust of the flesh, he traded the anointing of God. Every now and then, over the past 6,000 years of history, so many people got raised. Every one of them, or most of them, did that. So in these last days, God wants a people who will be a people whom he can trust to the uttermost. That's number one. Number two, these people will be like the donkey in Matthew 21. A donkey is someone who is nameless, faceless and selfless. You should have these three qualities. You don't care for your name, whether that credit is given to you or not. It will not bother you. You are faceless. You don't want to parade your name card. You know, dogs don't do that, you know. Have you ever seen a dog carrying a tag? Dog. Have you? No, the poor dog will just bow his head down on the ground and he just walks about, does not even lift up his head to notice who is coming, who's going. He just doesn't care. He just walks about. You will know a dog is coming by when he starts barking. Right? Only then you'll know, oh, there's a dog. Be careful. Only humans put up a sign, no? Beware of dogs. The dog never said, beware of me. Have you ever seen a dog pen with a sign, beware of me? No, the dogs don't do that, you know. So, second quality, faceless, nameless, and third quality, selfless. You are very, very selfless. You don't just care about you doing all the work. It will become a teamwork. Each helping one another, lifting him up, selfless. You know, a great man of God who lived in India, who has gone home to be with the Lord about 8 years ago, he was once caught up to heaven and he saw a vision. In this vision, he saw a huge table and many people seated on one side of the table and a delicious bowl of soup was put before each one of them. And he noticed that their hands were tied with a, or attached with a wooden spoon. A wooden spoon was attached to them. So the Lord told this man, take a look what's happening. So every one of them was struggling so hard. See, when your hand is attached to a wooden spoon, you can't bend your hand, right? How are you going to scoop the soup and drink? So every one of them was struggling, you know, like this. You can't even bring to your mouth. So they were every one of them were trying to do that, and they had all the soup spill on the floor. So he was standing there and looking at this whole phenomena. Then the Lord told him, you know, they could all have easily drank it if they had fed one another. You feed me, I feed you. Now take, drink. Okay, you bring your hand. They could have just easily. But this is what we are not doing today. But in the last days, the last days company that will rise up will be so selfless. It will not think about itself. It will think about feeding somebody else. Okay, let my brother rise up. Let him rise up. Let him do this. Let him do that. Let him do great exploits for God. Let me help him. Bring him up. So what if I don't get the name? So what if I'm not credited? So what if I stand behind in the shadows? That will be the last day's army of God's nature. Selfless, nameless, faceless. Amen. That is why all this pruning and refining and purification is taking place now. The process will lead towards a great shaking that will come. A great shaking that will shaken out the chaff, shaken out the wheat, the tares, sorry, and shaken out the goats, shaken out everything that is so far pretending to be a wheat, pretending to be a sheep, pretending to be holy when you are actually filthy. We have pretended so far, camouflage ourselves like what the Lord Jesus called the Pharisees. You are just whitewashed tombstones. Within you, you are full of dead men's bones. But externally, you put on this nice, beautiful robe of purity. Pretentious. You're just lying and cheating. Today you can fool everybody. But the eyes of God that sees beyond the flesh, looks into your heart, you cannot fool God. Can you? You can fool your church pastor, you can fool your spouses, you can fool your children, the children can fool the parents, you can fool anybody, you know. But you can never fool God. Because He looks true into your heart. If you read Acts chapter 8, the magician Simeon, he got saved